Neil Bush, why don't we start with your parents? Both your father and your mother were these incredible figures of history, and we can't forget how much they did also for China. Is there any story that your father shared with you as his son from the time that he lived in China or even afterwards as president?
He didn't really share stories. We actually visited China for 5 weeks during 1975. It overlapped, by the way, with the 4th of July. And China back in 1975 was a very, very different place. And it was really important, I think, in terms of U.S.-China relations that my father was the only president to have ever actually lived in China. And so as president and vice president before that, ambassador to the U.N., and before that, the chief liaison officer, he learned about China. He understood the subtleties and the nuances of working with the Chinese. And so as we've normalized relations, there couldn't have been a better, more impactful leader than my dad. China in 1975 was kind of a dark and freedomless place. And to see the explosion of freedom, to see the economy flourish in the season of openness has been really remarkable for me personally. And my dad, I think, had a lot of influence over the dynamics of that of the U.S.-China relationship that has led to great benefits to both sides.
Your first visit, as you said, as a young and during a formative period, 20.
Yeah, so I'm not that young.
Well, definitely during a formative period of your life, yes. Overlapped with July 4th, this great American holiday, which, yes, is also a global holiday. If you went to China now on July 4th, what would be the difference between the ways that you celebrate that and what would freedom speak about today?
Well, I'm not quite sure how the celebration would be that much different, honestly. Back July 4th, 1975, we hosted Chinese and others for a barbecue, a classic American tradition with hot dogs and hamburgers. And my parents had us all, my siblings were there as well, hanging banners and cooking the burgers and handing out the dogs. And it was a kind of a classic opportunity to show American hospitality on a really important holiday in our history. The difference, of course, would be that if you went to China today compared to 1975, you know, everything's different. Back in those days, you'd ride a bike from the residence, the U.S. residence, to Tiananmen Square, and you'd have to, you know, fight your way through thousands of bicyclers. And, you know, I remember riding my bike down the street and stop at a stoplight, and there'd be like 10 bikes, you know, to my side, left and right, and the guy would look over and almost fall off his bike seeing a big, you know, white guy with a long, big nose. And anyway, but today, you know, people are driving cars, and there's kind of this green movement. They're moving into electric, and you know, it's been an amazing transition to see the development of China and the stages of development, and to go through the industrial moment where, you know, all kinds of good came out of it, but also the challenges with air quality and pollution. And now to see in the last 3 years air quality getting to be much better in Beijing and other major cities, it's just to me, it's a marvel of, in my opinion, good governance, to see the government in five-year plan after five-year plan improve the quality of life for citizens, for so many citizens, so effectively. And Americans honestly don't really appreciate the positive benefit to the world of this human development that's taking place in China. And we need, my father taught me personally, that we need to embrace it and encourage collaboration and cooperation between our two great countries, because clearly our global challenges are growing, and we need to work together to solve major problems.
Your father and mother left their legacies. You have a legacy in process of your own as a contemporary leader. Yeah. And I've heard you speak about those goals in China. They're not simply vertical national goals. Mm-hmm. They're goals that China and the United States can really unify their positions on, yeah, for themselves and for wider social good.
Yeah.
What do you see? Do you see climate change or disease outbreak?
I see every major issue, and it's obvious to anyone that climate has become very volatile and is changing. And it's pretty clear to me that humans have the capacity to address major challenges. And people look at me like I'm crazy. But if part of climate change, part of it's human cause, but part of it's natural. You know, we have ice ages and, you know, heated ages and all those kinds of things. That even without human development on Earth, we'd have climate change. And my question is, why not bring the best minds from China, the U.S., and all over the world together to say, if the climate change is caused in part by human condition, then fine, let's change that. But if it's caused by natural conditions, can we change the natural condition? Can we change the tilt of the earth? There are tectonic activities that are moving big chunks of earth whenever there's a tsunami in Japan, move the earth by a tiny little fraction. That throws things out of sync. Can we put it back in sync in some way? How can we apply the best minds to deal with climate? How can we apply the best minds, like you mentioned, infectious disease outbreak? The Ebola outbreak in Africa is a good example of how China did their thing, we did our thing. If we did our things together, it would be a much more effective use of kind of international global resources and collaboration. I mean, there's so many issues with technology. I mean, I've heard complaint after complaint in Hong Kong and China and clearly in the U.S. The internet is being abused, by people who are promulgating false news or fake news or, divisive kinds of news. And there's got to be a way that we can establish global protocol for how to clean up the internet so that fakeness and falsities aren't spread so casually and with such terrible impact on dividing nations and dividing peoples within nations. So that kind of thing. There's the cybersecurity type issues. There's clearly terrorism issues. There are issues where civilized people on the planet Earth need to get together and work together to solve the problems. It's just simple. To me, it's profoundly simple to understand that we have to work together.
There is an obvious temptation to lean to one direction and say, Neil Bush, what would your father do? But I want to say, what would you do? You're the founder, you're the president of your own foundation on U.S.-China relations. If you could pick one of that myriad of complex issues that you just outlined there, where do you think could be a good starting point where it could be stripped of the noise around it and people can really get to work and create solutions?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there's just so many that need to be done, and I think you can do a lot of things simultaneously. I mean, my core belief is that through dialogue, through interaction, through different levels of interaction, from president to president down to working level and expert level, good things happen when you understand your opponent or the other side. If you put your shoes in the other guy's, put your place in the other guy's shoes, good things happen. Better understanding and more dialogue leads to more trust, and trust leads to mutually beneficial conclusions. So I'd be a huge advocate for developing more and deeper dialogue on all kinds of issues between the United States and China and everybody. Globally, it's not just the U.S. and China. My dad had often stated that the U.S.-China bilateral relationship is the most important relationship in the world. He believed that at his core. As China develops, it's becoming very clear that it's true. And so we need to find ways to have dialogue.
I want to ask you, in closing, we have different languages, different cultures, different systems of governance, different histories, different roots of civilization. But me, I'm not the expert here, but I always think that the American and Chinese are actually very similar. They're very ambitious, they're able to do it, and they execute as well. But you have a far richer insight. I think this is your 150th and something trip to China. And of course, you went there during the years when it was very difficult, back in the early 1970s, when it was mired in its own national problems. Mm-hmm. You've seen it change, as you describe over there. What is China to you? What are Chinese to you? If you could break it down.
I've learned a lot about China from being in China in 1975 and visiting over 140 times. And it's shaped my global view. For example, I don't believe that democracies work for every country. Clearly in China, they've established a model that works for China. China's created the five-year plan model every year. It's improved the quality of life. People are enjoying more freedoms than you could have imagined 44 years ago. And so as China develops, as the institutions, become more mature, as the judicial process, as intellectual property protection, as the middle class grows, things will change in China. It's become more pluralistic. It's become more meritocracy based. But in Chairman Mao's days, it was a communist country with a dictator, and it was everybody marched in lockstep.
Did you meet him that trip?
I did not meet him. No, my dad met him, and there's a famous picture of he and Chairman Mao back in the day. But since then, since Deng Xiaoping has opened the door, there's been an amazing transformation, and it continues to be transformed. And as I mentioned in my speech, China is inching closer and closer to what people in America call the American dream, and President Xi has called the Chinese dream. And I think it's the American dream with Chinese characteristics, because people are enjoying more freedoms, more luxuries, more opportunities now than they could have ever imagined 44 years ago. So I've learned that democracy doesn't work for everybody. Every country has different sets of institutional systems and historical and cultural development or histories. And that leads, the best system for that country is going to be different, so long as the care and concern for the people of those countries is number one priority. And I believe that China is run by people of good intent, that are smart and well-educated, that are have had their leadership skills honed at different levels of government, rising to become senior leaders. And so I have confidence that China will continue to be well-led.
I'm excited, but I think the world should be excited about how you're going to extend your leadership of the Bush Foundation that you created in honor of your parents, but also equally in this rapidly changing world, how you're going to reshape global society for the good.
Doing my best. I might add that in addition to being chairman of the Bush Foundation, Bush China Foundation, which I founded with my dad's blessing 3 years ago, I'm the chairman of an organization called Points of Light, which is leading a global movement towards voluntary service to others. My dad always believed and called on people to find their capacity to help lift individuals, lift communities, be a point of light in the lives of others. And so there's a global movement that the United States is kind of the center pin for all this activity, but it's spreading internationally. And I'm very proud of my dad's, first his personal commitment to history, but his legacy of promoting service and understanding and trust and lifting others. His whole life was dedicated to finding the best in others and helping people realize their fullest potential. And it worked in both the diplomatic front, but also in personal front. So I feel like I'm a very blessed man to have the opportunity to promote really important family legacies that really can have, and I hope will have, a big and positive impact on society. So thank you, James.
Neil Bush, thank you for lending and sharing that light.
Thank you.